Forsythshire residents want answers, redistribution of storm relief funds. Dominica's vulnerability risk high months after Tropical Storm Erica. And the Dominica National Council on Women urges authorities to consider national action on recent attacks on women. I'm Idonaja Baptist with the Channel 5 News. Details coming up. Welcome back. Some residents of Forsythshire are expressing disappointment because they did not receive funds assigned for those affected by Tropical Storm Erica in the community. The Bagatelle Village Council has been responsible for distributing the funds. However, residents complain that some of the people who have received funds were either not impacted or seriously impacted when compared to their situation. They spoke to Channel 5 News after visiting the Bagatelle Village Council office on Friday.
Because when I reach here, it's like this morning, they're telling me, it's like, yeah, your name not there. I even feel bad. I check in what? I lose everything. I lose my house. I lose everything. I lose my mattress, my stove, my plates, my fork, everything, my net, everything I had. I had blocks, 160-something blocks, almost going to have a starting. Up there now is like one, two distillery that day. I sleeping in distillery on the street IB.
I have to make two operations in my house. Go to the sea. We are waiting to see what we will get. When we go to the council, they say our name is not on list. We cannot get money. I go to the council and the clerk tell me my name is not there. Ayoka name is not there. And we lose and missing. And we lose everything in our home. Well, I live in under our old house that is uncovered. And when water fall in, everything I have there is waiting. In the village itself, the big house on the side of where I used to have my little house.
Although this young man from Forsythshire benefited, his issue is that the funds are not enough.
We went to a meeting with the PAL rep, Dr. Daru, and he informed us that the money was there since before Christmas. But none of us did not know. Although I have two children and I lose all what I had. Check, and then people give me little more. Like I lose my home with everything in it.
Everything in it.
I just had time to save me and my two children and my girlfriend. They give us a little, they give me, I can say the amount, they give me $3,000. So we're just asking for a little more assistance, a little more help.
Meantime, chairperson of the Bagatelle Village Council, Angela Martin, told Channel 5 News all the monies have been distributed. She says $64,000 was made available to the council by the Ministry of Social Services late December as part of Storm Erica relief.
The money came accompanied by a list. And then the money was distributed according to the list. Because we got all kinds of, you know, name calling and so on. People accuse us of and even people accuse me as a chairperson of being my friend from the funds and so on. And then that is not true at all. I am not too sure whether everybody has received their checks. We wrote all the checks for the people who were supposed to have received it. For Bagatelle and Conservation.
In other top stories, Dominica's vulnerability to natural disasters post-Tropical Storm Erica is still significantly increased. Andrea Louis has that story.
The tropical storm of August 2015 cost the country $1.29 billion in damage and destroyed roads, bridges and buildings by landslides and floods. Almost 5 months after the event, Dominica still remains more at risk to natural disasters should they occur.
We continue to see the effects of Erica. There are a number of infrastructural works that has to be done to bring us out from that vulnerability stage. In fact, before Erica, we were already one of the most vulnerable places in the Caribbean, given our level of exposure to the various hazards, volcanic hazard, the flood risk hazard, the fact that we have hurricane season, the tsunami hazard.
Dominica's vulnerability to man-made disasters has also grown in recent time.
The man-made hazards, health, we had chikungunya, now we have the Zika, we had a threat of Ebola was around in our sphere. Thank God that it did not reach the Caribbean. But those are factors that we have to take into consideration. We had a number of fires last year, for example. That too, we are vulnerable to. So it's a whole array of hazards that we need to plan for and to manage.
The acting disaster coordinator says Dominica has a lot of preparation work to do, as some natural disasters do not have particular seasons.
Sometimes they confuse the word resilience with after the fact. Your resilience is supposed to be before the impact. You're supposed to be resilient. You need to build your resilience. And in the future, we want to see that that resilience built into our people, that we can manage properly or in a better position to manage.
More relief items are still on offer by the Adventist Development and Relief Agency, and Tropical Storm Erica victims are being urged to collect them.
ADRA's local coordinator, Nurse Priscilla Prevo, says they are still managing the distribution of several items donated from abroad. Food and drink items which were donated to the church had already been shared out to affected people. However, she says there may be people who have not been able to receive clothes even if a lot has been distributed on their end.
A lot of clothing have come into Dominica, and some persons are saying that, well, some communities, they are overwhelmed with clothing, but I'm sure that there are still people who need clothing. It's difficult to give people clothing, so persons need to come and select for themselves. So we are appealing to persons. We still have clothing in Goodwill, but we're trying to distribute what we have at the church in Salisbury. What we did with the food and water, we packaged the stuff, and we actually went to the homes to deliver those supplies.
Prevo says more goods are on their way to Dominica to assist those who are still badly affected by the tropical storm.
We are still receiving some supplies, although the main relief period is over, but some persons who collected stuff, sometimes it takes time to ship and to get things going. So we are still receiving some supplies that we are providing assistance to persons who are in need and persons who have been affected.
ADRA had also helped in the academic aspect of the post-Erica recovery by contributing $75,000 towards students' education at various levels.
In other stories, a five-year-long partnership which has helped to develop the technical and vocational skills of Dominican youth is coming to an end. More from Andrea Louis.
The CARICOM Education for Employment CEFE program aims to contribute to economic growth through a more competitive, productive, and gender equitable workforce in the Caribbean. The CEFE project results in increased and more meaningful employment for technical, vocational, education, and training TVET graduates and skilled workers in the region. It is funded by the Canadian International Development Agency.
And of course, the TVET Council was born to help with coordination, to help with producing homogeneity, because you know, once a thing starts to be done all over the place, then we run into the problem of diminishing quality. So the TVET Council has been brought on board, was created basically to ensure the quality of that process is not compromised in any way. So the value of a TVET practitioner can only grow and become better. The Caribbean Association of National Training Agencies, charged by CARICOM with ensuring that a single process is initiated in every single island to ensure that we develop TVET practitioners that will serve our free movement of labor, services, goods, and the rest.
A CEFE representative encouraged Dominica to look for further opportunities to continue the development of its human resource capacity.
That as the CEFE program starts to wind down, as this partnership comes to its official close, although we know that the relationship will extend beyond the official partnership, I do want to urge Dominica to continue to work with regional partners to implement the CBQ. So even if CEFE is gone and even if Linda is gone, there are still lots of opportunities in networking which have been established through this project that should assist Dominica and the TVET Council to move forward with the implementation of NVQs and CVQs.
Dominica was applauded for starting the Caribbean Vocational Qualification CVQ program in secondary schools, as this can reap several benefits for students.
And for those of you who don't know about the Caribbean Vocational Qualification, that's really important because it is your ticket to move without a work permit throughout the CARICOM region. And so it's important to provide that opportunity for the citizens of Dominica so that they can compete equally with those citizens in other countries already awarding the CVQ.
The program was launched in 12 CARICOM countries in 2011. Andrea Louis, Channel 5 News.
On the carnival scene, a veteran costume builder has added his voice to support early planning of carnival. Head of the costume builders mass camp, Dan Ligai, says the situation due to the impact of Tropical Storm Erica and the short carnival season this time around has put an additional strain on costume builders.
Normally we have 6 weeks. Right now we only have 3 weeks to build the costumes, and the same costumes we have to build. And it's not only one show. We have the Queen show, we have the Teenage Pageant, we have the Princess show, we have the Mother's Queen show. So we're building for everybody. So everything's a bit late and funds were a bit late. But we try, and we should be there on track by the Queen show.
Guy, who's the recipient of a Meritorious Service Award, is proposing that sponsorship for Queen contestants should be sought much earlier.
I think Carnival, if we're doing Carnival, we should start at least in the middle of the year, start putting things in place. Costume builders, we all work. We all have a job. And for us to suspend our work just to do things in a rush, I find it's not right. We should start somewhere 2-3 months in advance so we could take our time, build the things properly and get something better on the road than starting 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks before the show. Say by August, everything's supposed to start rolling from there. Start putting your girls in place, start putting, you know, and to give the sponsors a time to really think about it, you know.
You're watching Channel 5 News. We'll be right back with more. Thanks for staying tuned. The Dominica National Council of Women is appealing to the authorities and civil organizations to treat the recent attacks on women as a national crisis. This comes on the heels of the rape of two elderly women in 2 months and the murder of a Brazilian woman who lived on island. The hierarchy of DNCW says this is cause for national action.
If our human resource, women whom all of us know, are located in various areas of national development, if they seem to be the one being targeted and attacked, I would think that that is at a time that we have to set aside to discuss as a nation and to take drastic actions to deal with it. We are calling on all the institutions of influence, the church, the women's organizations, the men's organizations, the police, the Council on Aging, all of those institutions, and of course the government, to make this issue a national issue.
Part of its plan is to partner with the Council on Aging to start a program in communities which addresses the protection of elderly people. DNCW is concerned these violent crimes against women are creating fear among our populace.
We welcome the idea that the laws are being revised, but we also feel that more drastic action needs to be taken in relation to the way that the perpetrators are dealt with. We are and will be working with the Dominica Council on Aging, who has a register of the various elderly persons at the various communities, and to ensure that there is something in place to deal with them.
Meantime, President of DNCW Vanya David has vowed to rally communities to get support to advocate against violence against women. She addressed a march organized by the Calabishi community on Friday to show solidarity in the wake of the attack on Rose Wyatt, who made her home in that area.
We will not rest without addressing this concern. We will not only use the media to address it, but we will use community like yours and seek your assistance to work with us on this evil. We have started before the murder of Rose, and we will continue to advocate on behalf of women who suffered gender-based violence.
A women's rights activist told the audience that they should expose perpetrators of these crimes, even if it is someone they are related to.
Do not wait until it visits your home. Now that you have a chance to speak up on behalf of those who are being abused. Open your mouth and say something. For those people who know who the perpetrators are, but because they are our blood relatives, we love them too much to give them up. Let me tell you, that is not love. The best thing you can do for them, hand them over to the police. They will get the treatment they deserve. They will be put away where they need to be, so our communities will be safer and our headaches will be less.
A top cop stationed at Kalibishi is concerned with youth in particular who are using illegal drugs and has appealed to communities to report those who give drugs to minors. Inspector Romain Riviere, while addressing the Kalibishi rally, thanked the community for giving the police tips which led to the arrest of a 17-year-old from Woodford Hill related to the death of Rose Wyatt. He encouraged the community to continue communication with the police on crimes that affect the youth.
We have a hotline that you can call at any time where you can give information. Don't be scared to sell out those people who are giving drugs to your children. Those people who are selling alcohol to your minors. It is time that you, the people of Kalibishi, put your foot down and start helping the police to prosecute those people. This 17-year-old who allegedly committed this heinous crime, that is the culmination of the use of drugs. The use of alcohol at tender age, that is the culmination of it.
Inspector Riviere says the public should impress the need for stricter laws on the authorities.
And I want to implore you people, continue to advocate. Continue to advocate to the powers that be in this country to enforce stricter laws and to ensure that the laws that are on the books of the, in the Commonwealth of Dominica are enforced to the highest degree when these sort of heinous crimes occur. It is time for us to put our mouth, our money where our mouth is.
And Domlek has fully restored its hydroelectric system in the Roseau Valley after the devastation of Tropical Storm Erica last August. Lurian Graham Carter has that story.
The hydro system allows electricity to be generated without importing diesel. It also assists in keeping the fuel surcharge at its lowest. As of late December, generation at the hydroelectric plant has been in full effect. Generation manager of the electricity company, Dave Stamm, told a news conference on Monday that customers were fortunate that the price of fuel was decreasing while the hydro system was not fully operational.
The fuel surcharge is dependent on the amount of diesel that you use to produce electricity. And the price of that fuel that we import on the world market, right? Now, when the hydro system was down or was not up to full capacity after Erica, we had to replace the lost capacity with diesel. Right? So that potentially had the potential effect of raising the fuel surcharge.
Tropical Storm Erica had caused $5 million in damage to the hydro system at Purdue in Trafalgar. It was reported as the hardest hit area of the company's properties. Stamm says there is still infrastructural work to be done.
This year, probably by the end of the year, because there are a lot of civil infrastructure and engineering works that have to be done to restore some of these structures. We hope to have those structures restored by the end of the year. But we will do so in a way that it does not affect the operation of the hydro plants. So persons in the Roseau River, and Mr. Charles mentioned about the pipelines, please protect our pipelines because it is not just for Domlek. The integrity of those pipeline goes translates right down to your electricity bill.
Currently, the hydroelectric system produces 30% of the island's electricity. Lurian Graham Carter, Channel 5 News.
In tonight's chit chat, I'm joined by Wadix, and you know what that means. We're talking about Calypso. It's royalty and champions night at the Stardom Calypso tent. Wadix, tell us more about this.
Well, that's where we head into a different dimension. That's where we head into a different level where we separate the men from the boys. And this Wednesday we'll be having the royalty night and also sponsors championship. That's when we dissect the tent into five groups, each headed by a monarch or a prominent personality in stardom: Hunter, Scrunter, Daddy Chess, The Web, and Observer. And each of those captains will head and represent a sponsor. And the sponsors are Digicel, Domlek, also Big Edge, Caribbean, and Appleton Rum. And each team will be headed by the captain with five members. And then the beautiful thing about this championship is you will never know who you're going to sing against. So if I decide I'm going to send you, Idona, and then whoever else, the captain from the other team decide, they will send against Idona. And that's why we are innovative and creative at Stardom Tent. And then we allow for royalty, where we had invited the Miss Teen Pageants, Miss Dominica contestants, also Mother's Queen Show and Miss Jamboree. And we will have a fantastic time. So we are urging patrons to do come down, dress to impress. It's going to be a classy night. And Stardom Tent, the official and number one authentic Kaiso tent in Dominica.
Certainly an entertaining package being offered by Stardom Tent this Wednesday night. Be sure to check it out. Sports is next.
Hello everyone, and thanks for joining us. First up in sports, Tuesday's edition of the United Insurance Secondary School's Under 20 Cricket Championships kicked off with three games of play at Botanic Gardens.
St. Mary's Academy batted first, scoring 169, Anakin Moore 34, Taj Tavernier 28, Terrell Tusa 28, Daniel Dupini 25. Bowling for Goodwill, Javon Raphael 3-for-51, Dayon Day 2-3-for-34. Goodwill bowled out for 96, with Cody Filbert top scoring with 49. Bowling for SMA, Daniel Dupini 4-for-20, Terrell Tusa 3-for-27, SMA won first innings points.
Then down the road at Windsor Park.
PHL Secondary scored 188-for-9 declared, Alec Athanas 139. Bowling for Grammar School, Kasim Peltier 2-for-55, Ethan Doctrove 2-for-32, M. Payne 2-for-31. DGS replied with 176 all-out, Kasim Peltier 27, Ryan Prosper 20 in the first innings. DGS was sent in to bat again, Kasim Peltier 64, Ryan Prosper 33. DGS ended on 151 all-out in the second innings. PCSS was set 40, but that match was drawn in the end.
And at Benjamin's Park,
that match was washed out by rainfall.
Meantime, on the international cricket scene, home advantage favoured South Africa as they closed off their fourth and final test against England with a 280-run win. Quinton de Kock top scored with 129 not out, with much-needed assistance coming from Stephen Cook and Hashim Amla, who recorded 115 and 109 respectively. South Africa was all out for 475 in the first innings. Kegiso Rabada and Moin Markel wreaked havoc in the English batsmen lineup. Rabada took 7 for 112 and Markel 2 for 73. England in reply scored 342 all out. Joe Root and Alastair Cook both registered 76, with Moeen Ali adding 61. Ben Stokes took 4 for 86 for England. In the second innings, South Africa totaled 248 for 5 declared. Hashim Amla contributed 96 and Themba Mabuva 78 not out. Set 382 to win, Kegiso Rabada and Moin Markel unleashed a vicious bowling attack on the English batsmen, together taking 9 wickets. England was all out for 101 with no visiting batsmen topping James Taylor's 24. England won the series 2-1. Moving on to track and field, 4 athletes have qualified for this year's Curifta Games at the development meet at Benjamin's Park on Sunday. The Dominica Amateur Athletics Association, DAAA, hosted its first meet of the year, where the following athletes met the qualifying standards ahead of the Curifta Games. The 4 down to represent Dominica are Jabez Ferrara in the under 20 boys 5,000 meters, leading 17 minutes and 42 seconds, clocked 16 minutes and 42.8 seconds. Keon Burton in the under 18 boys javelin required 53 meters and threw a distance of 57.29 meters. Just to say, in the under 18 boys discus category, needed 40.2 to qualify and recorded a throw of 42.34. And Danielson Mahuse in the under 18 boys 100 meters needed 10.9 seconds to qualify and recorded 10.6 seconds. PRO of the DAAA, Walson Packett, urges athletes and coaches to remain in preparation mode for the CARIFTA and other regional competitions.
Athletes and coaches should also take note that after qualification have been achieved, there should be an upward movement in the athlete's performance, and that the DAAA executive, through its selection committee, reserves the right to determine the final team size as well as participants.
The CARIFTA Games are carded for March 25 to 28, 2016 in Grenada. In football, national football coach and selector Shane Marshall says there is still room for improvement to boost the standards of football locally. He highlighted increased leg strength in local footballers as one of the key factors that may improve their performance.
I think we could be a little bit more aggressive on the ball, you know, more aggression, and even our technique, lacking technique and so on the ball. We're getting pushed off the ball really easily, you know, which I mean, after this. Strength in our players, you know, that's one of the things I spoke really deeply about, having a gym for a national team to play football and get some strength, you know, because a lot of times that they need last couple of tournaments to play. Because your players are pushing up the ball. It's not that they haven't got skills, you know, but some of them, they are not strong players.
Marshall recognizes, however, that there are footballers who play exceptionally well in some instances.
The game between Southeast and Dubla. That was very much competitive, you know, it was much faster than all the other games, and you could see the nice touches on the ball, some nice diagonal passing, some nice goals scored, you know, and to me that is the kind of aggression.
In rounders, president of the National Rounders Committee, Abraham Brown, says the recently concluded National Rounders League ended on a positive note, and he is looking forward to greater things in the sport in the future. His comments come at the finals of the National Rounders League on Sunday, where Dubuque Strikers won by 301 runs over NCC UDOM Setco Stars.
It was a successful league. We had over 89 games played, and we had close to 400 players. We initiated a disciplinary committee, and we didn't have to go to that disciplinary committee. So from that aspect, I think it's very good. What we'd probably like is that based on the success this year, that we'll probably get sponsors to get, so that we can have more incentives, so we can get still more players involved.
And finally, in forehand domino played Sunday, in Zone A, Swansea 4010, Golden Arms 2,869, Fire Services 4,013, Execute 2,790, Remix 4,001, Rabbit Hole 3,489, Jam Down 1 by default. In Zone B, Marino Mon Zion 4,000, Stars 2,881, Giants 4,002, Homeboys 3,489, Dolphins 4,010, Task Force 3,943. The game between Rebels and Barbie 007 and Metrics versus Almotors Valiants were postponed on Sunday and will play during this week because of a poor turnout. That's all the time we have for sports. I am Kenny Williams. Join us again next time.
The weather report is next.
Good evening. Welcome to tonight's weather broadcast. The Atlantic high pressure system continue to be the dominant feature across the island chain, with some low level clouds lingering across parts of the island chain, with hazy and breezy conditions evident today. Here in Dominica, partly cloudy skies were reported today, with radar imagery indicating limited shower activity. For tonight, the weather is expected to be partly cloudy with a few scattered showers, and for tomorrow, fair to partly cloudy skies with some brief showers can be expected. Sea conditions are expected to be moderate to rough in open water, with waves peaking near 10 feet. The small craft warning remains in effect for above normal seas. For the next 3 days, expect fair to partly cloudy skies with brief showers and breezy conditions. For the remainder of the Caribbean, the Atlantic high pressure system will continue to be the dominant feature, resulting in generally fair weather conditions tomorrow. On the international cities forecast, partly cloudy skies in New York, thunderstorm activity in Miami, rain in London, and generally fair weather conditions in Caracas and Beijing. The sun will rise tomorrow at 6:36 a.m. and set at 6:01 p.m. For additional information, feel free to contact us at weather.gov.dm or call the weather hotline at 447-5555. Thank you for joining us and have a good night.
To end the news, the headlines again. Forcesia residents want answers, redistribution of storm relief funds. Dominica's vulnerability risk high months after Tropical Storm Erica. And the Dominica National Council of Women urges authorities to consider national action on recent attacks on women. Email us at news@marpin2k4.com and visit our YouTube channel to catch up on our past newscasts. On behalf of the production team, I'm Idona Jean-Baptiste. Join us again tomorrow.